Good afternoon and welcome back to my workbench, where things happen sometimes, eventually. So it was just Easter this past weekend, and I decided to take a break, and that's why this video is a bit late. I actually tried to do this video yesterday, but I didn't feel that great, so decided I'd do it today anyway. So here we go. So this is slightly different than usual. It's not a computer thing, it's not a TV or anything like that. It's still electronic though. These are some ignition control, well, not really controllers, but kind of ignition modules from a Suzuki motorbike. One my uncle owns, he lives in Australia, and he sent these to me because I'm pretty sure all of them are faulty in some way. They're from a pretty old, I think, 1987 maybe, Suzuki GSX750ESD. I believe that's what he told me. So I pretty sure that's what these are from, or something very similar to that anyway, if that wasn't correct. Anyway, these are before CDI ignition, actually, so I was a bit confused when I first was talking to him about these, because I thought they were capacitive discharge ignition, but they're actually, they predate that. They're basically just sort of an electronic equivalent of the points, standard points, a mechanical ignition controller. Or whatever it is. I'm not a vehicle expert, I'm not a mechanic. But these things, they basically just take an input from a little coil that's connected to the engine, and they fire the spark plugs when they receive that that signal. So, and the spark plugs are just done purely inductively with the self-inductance of the ignition coil, so there's no capacitive discharge, there's no electronic thing for that. So they purely just switch the coils on and off. They don't actually provide any power to the coils themselves. So that's all done. So it's a very simple system, but apparently these don't work. I'm going to take a look at these. I've got two here that are apparently original Suzuki parts. He told me this one was the original from his bike. I don't know if that was factory original or just a second-hand one that was original when he bought the bike, or not. But anyway, these two are genuine original Suzuki ones, and this is an aftermarket one, which I'm not entirely sure who made this. There's no brand name on it or anything. But anyway, apparently there's something wrong with all of them. So I thought I'd have a look inside, try and analyze the fault, see if we can figure out what's wrong with them. Maybe I can even fix one of them, I'm not sure. I think at least with these two, maybe I can get one working one out of these two. Maybe, I don't know. We'll see. I was going to do this video quite a while ago, a few months ago, 2-3 months ago I think, but I realized it would be quite difficult and annoying to do it without this power supply, so I wanted to build that first. So yeah, so sorry about that. Why this has taken a while, but eventually I've got around to it. Anyway, so I have actually opened these two and been kind of looking around at them. That's what they look like on the inside. Quite simple, really. You've got two transistors here, Darlington transistors that drive the coils. Well, they don't drive them, they just switch them, complete the circuit to ground, basically. The coils are permanently connected to the 12 volts, and then these just connect them to ground and let the current go through. Got some diodes, capacitors, input stuff, and then underneath this is some sort of hybrid module chip thing. Probably, maybe even discrete components, might be some op amps and stuff based on discrete transistors, I'm not sure. Obviously it's all potted and everything like that, so I can't really easily look inside, but there's no, this one will probably be microcontroller controlled. This one is probably almost all analog stuff, or maybe even, a small amount of digital in there or something. Maybe like a basic counter or like a sort of a 555 or something like that, timer or something, but I would say most of this would be just analog stuff. All the input circuitry is anyway. It's just resistors, capacitors, diodes, basically. They're quite simple. I'm not entirely sure what's gone wrong with them. Sort of hard to test, I guess, when you don't actually have a bike, but hey, I've come up with an idea of how I think I can test them, so I'll give that a go later on. But for now, I'll just I'll just take a more in-depth look at these, and we'll just see see if we can figure out what's wrong with them, maybe, or something. Yeah, who knows? Okay, so just getting a bit more close up on these modules here. I don't think I can really look at this aftermarket one because the whole thing is potted, as you can probably see, in some sort of resin, so to get that open would be a bit of a mission, and I'm not entirely sure I'd be able to do anything with it anyway. So I think I'll have to forget about this one for the moment, and focus solely on these two original ones, because the glue around this was very easy to pull out, so quick look at this. This is the original one. This one has a fairly obvious fault when you pull the cover off, and you can see this resistor here is quite toasty and burnt up. So yeah, obviously something's not right here. Even this glue has melted from the heat and dripped down onto this connector here. So yeah, the resistor is not looking good. I traced out a schematic for this thing. It's pretty easy, I guess. The board's all single-sided. I'll show that in a second. But this resistor feeds basically a sort of zener diode regulator and some sort of maybe reference input pin for this this hybrid module. It also provides power to a couple of pull-up resistors which connect to the inputs. So shouldn't really need much power at all. And if we look at the other one, we can see I've started pulling the glue off this one, but you can see the resistor in here is perfectly fine, so you know, under normal operation that shouldn't get hot at all or anything. So this one, definitely something must have shorted out to burn that resistor like that. So could be the zener diode itself, which is under the side here, or it could be the hybrid module has gone bad. I measured the resistance across this diode. It's about 1.5K, so I'm not sure if the diode's maybe gone open circuit. Maybe it's shorted, then gone open, which means this would have seen the full 12 volts. So who knows, this could be damaged, I'm not sure. So yeah, can't really tell without desoldering this diode. And of course that's hard because it's underneath this, so I'll have to take this out. But might have a look at that one afterwards, but this one is maybe a bit more likely to be able to do something with. So the diode under here, this one is actually shorted. I desoldered one leg of it. There was a dead short across this. I desoldered one leg, poked it through the board, and the short was gone. So when I measured across these pads again, so this diode has definitely gone shorted. I'm not sure you can see on the side there, but it actually says 6.2, so that's pretty good. So it's a 6.2 volt diode. I wasn't sure of that when I drew up the schematic, but I should at least be able to desolder this module, desolder that diode, replace the diode with a new one, and just see what happens. Maybe the module's fine, maybe the diode's just shorted out. I suppose if the... Yeah, the fact that this resistor's really burnt, I guess, indicates to me that probably more than just this diode was shorted on this one. So this one, the module might be completely bad. So maybe no hope for this one possibly, but this one maybe is just could be just the zener is shorted, and if I replace that, it might work. What I'll do is I'll desolder this thing here, and I'll take out this diode, I'll put a new one in, and I'll hook it up to some power, and then I'll see if it's possible to test it, see if I can get anything out of it. I've got a page out of the service manual which explains a basic way to test these, so I'm going to try that. And I'm also going to try my method that I've thought of as well, which may also work, but anyway. So yeah, it's a very simple thing. The only difference really between these two boards is the number on this module. You can see one says HI121, the other one's HI115. I don't know what that means, if they're different revisions or different actual versions. And these resistors over here on the sides there, they are different values on these. Everything else is the same, but these resistors over here, and the way they've done it, it looks like they've sort of added these sort of trimming resistors on these pins. So it looks like possibly this is designed to calibrate the module in some way. It's some sort of external timing resistor or something. So yeah, I guess that's why these are different. These are going to be unique for each module, I suppose. So those resistors there, but everything else was identical between the two. And yeah, so like I said, I'm going to take this, swap this diode out, and we can have a look and see what's going on. I did try connecting these to 12 volts. This one drew 50 milliamps, and this one drew 200. Which makes sense, I guess, given the shorter zener. Okay, so just to have a look at this, I've desoldered these connections here to the hybrid module with solder wick, but the leads are bent over, so I have to bend them back, and that's kind of hard to do when they're still kind of soldered onto the board. So I take this knife here and heat the lead up and slide the blade in under the lead, and then just twist, and you can see it bends the lead. So quite kind of tricky, but yeah, quite easy on this board at least, because the pads are nice and big. Of flux holding these on. Just gotta bend them over. Let's get them all straight. There we go. Now it should just come out. There we go. Oh no. That's all some sort of soft stuff. Huh. How very odd. I don't know if that's done that because I've heated it up, but how strange. It's like sort of a, like melted cheese. Weird. I assume that would be just potted. But I guess not. In fact, this whole thing is like, sort of gooey. It's like these pins are connected to a circuit board that's sort of stuck inside this sort of jelly, whatever it is. Huh. Hopefully that was on camera. But yeah, okay, so this diode here is definitely shorted. So I can
take that out.
Hmm. 6.2
says on there, 6.2. So, yeah, 6.2 volt zener, I guess. Now I'm just going to scrape this glue, but I don't think this is the really crap conductive glue. And this stuff hasn't corroded anything. And it, yeah, it doesn't appear to be that same stuff that you get nowadays. Another diode there. Some resistors.
But yeah, let's replace that diode and see if this thing starts working. I've got some new ones here. They're 6.2 volts, 500 milliwatts. They are smaller probably than this one, which may be 1 watt or maybe 2 watts. But with the 100 ohm resistor in series, the maximum dissipation for this without a load will be 350 milliwatts. So, you know, that's within the rating of this. And this might just be bigger because it's older. I'm not sure. Well, they probably uprated it for reliability. But anyway, for testing, these should do. So, just for fun, you can actually see what happens when you connect these diodes. So, this one, for example, is the shorted one, the original one. I've got the current limit all the way down to minimum, which is about 10 milliamps. And if I connect this diode here, we turn the load on, you can see the voltage drops straight to zero because it's a short, so I've got the limit has gone up to about 10 milliamps, but yeah, the voltage has dropped from 12, I've got it set to 12, drops straight down to zero when I put this on. You can see the limit LED comes on. Yeah, so I haven't put knobs on this yet. I've actually got some knobs. But they don't have any grub screws, so I've ordered some grub screws on eBay for those. Anyway, that's beside the point, though. So, if we get a new zener diode, this is a actual 6.2. This one here, if we connect this the same way, obviously making sure the stripe is connected to the positive side. I'm using two red leads, so that might be a little confusing, but this one's definitely connected to the positive, this one's the negative. You want to reverse bias it for zener to test that, and if I switch that on, you can see the voltage drops to about 6 volts, which is what you'd expect. So this one is not shorted, and this one is working. Obviously, you do want to make sure the current is limited to about 10 or 20 milliamps. You don't want to go very high. If I had the current limit off, this would just blow up. But yeah, you can see that's that is working compared to the other one. So it is actually going to the it's clamping the voltage, and the current's being limited. So it's all how you'd expect. So yeah, that one's working. So that's an easy way to test your zener diodes. Anyway, is just use something like this and make sure the current's limited to a small amount. And the datasheet often supplies a test current at which the zener diode is normally spec'd at. So I'll just solder this diode in now and put the module back in. So you've got to bend the leads correctly. You can sort of measure them against that. About 5 millimeters each side. Just bend it with your fingernail. It's not too hard. Bend that over a little bit, and I'll put my extractor fan on. This will get quite smoky. There we go. Do what we want.
And I should be able to put this back in now. Four pins lined up, there we go.
Okay, so hopefully this will work. But I won't bend the pins over this time. So if I do need to take this thing off again, it'll be easier. Inspect that for any solder bridges, but that looks all right. So now, just have to connect it up and see what happens. Okay, so now I've got the thing hooked up to 12 volts from my power supply here. And this one was drawing 200 milliamps before when I had the shorted diode. When I turn it on now, it only draws about 100. So that looks good, and now if I probe the voltages here, this is my ground connection, we've got the input to the protection diode, that's 12 volts, 11.98, and the output of the protection diode, 11.2, obviously there's a voltage drop, and then if I test on the output of this resistor here, we get 6.3. So the zener diode is now working. Previously I was getting 0.1 volts at this point. So yeah, the zener is now working again. Whether or not the rest of the circuit will work, I don't know. But we'll have a look. Okay, so I didn't have time to finish this video yesterday, so I've come back today and I'm continuing. I did some work on this one as well. Obviously, as you can see, I replaced both the zener and the resistor. The zener I initially assumed might have gone open circuit, allowing the voltage to become too high and damage the module, possibly cause it to short out and then burn the resistor. That was the most logical theory I could think of, because that sort of thing is usually what happens. But the zener here is actually perfectly fine. It tested as 6.2 volts. And it's not shorted, not open. It seems like it's working perfectly fine. So, also, I replaced this with a new zener just in case, and I replaced this resistor with 5 watt 120 ohms. That's all I had that was suitable. This is 100 ohms at 3 watts, I'm going to guess, but yeah, I didn't have anything like that, but this will do for testing. I connected it up to the power supply and gave it 12 volts, and it actually drew about 100 milliamps just like the other one. So yeah, no excessive current draw, nothing got hot, nothing started smoking, so it's pretty strange. I don't really understand. I just assumed that this module would have had some sort of short, but there's nothing obvious underneath this module here when I pulled it out, just the same white sort of jelly stuff. Nothing looked burnt or anything, so yeah, and the resistors underneath were all fine, the other diode under there checked out fine, and there's nothing else seems to be wrong with this one, so apart from that burnt resistors, I don't know, it's very strange. It's as if this resistor has just burnt by itself, which, you know, that doesn't really happen. It doesn't seem to make any sense, unless it was, you know, running hard in a really hot environment or something, and the power dissipation plus the ambient temperature was just too much for it and it burnt up. I don't know, but it seems odd considering the fact that the other one, you know, if we look at the other one here, hang on. If we look at the other one, the resistor is basically in perfect condition. You know, there's no sign of even of heat damage at all. It's not even brown slightly. This glue right next to it is still exactly the same color everywhere. There's no burning. Not compared with this one, where the glue is very dark next to where the resistor was. So, it's very strange. I mean, the board here is perfectly clear. There's no discoloration there. Whereas with this one, you can clearly see there's a sort of a browned area. The traces go slightly brown around this area where the resistor was, and So I don't know. I don't know what the difference is. I don't know why this resistor burnt. It seems odd. The only other thing I can think of is the fact my uncle told me the actual input coils for this, the sense coils that sense the position of the engine, crankshaft and all that, that provide the input to this that tells it when to fire the spark plugs. The only thing I can think of is he told me that the coils also tested bad, so not only did he have to replace the igniter module, he also had to replace the sense coils. So maybe they weren't running properly, maybe the input was bad, it wasn't getting the correct waveform it was supposed to get, and it, maybe this thing, I don't know, I mean, could it have locked up and drawn excess current and burnt out the resistor, or could it have, you know, maybe the input voltage was too low, that this thing basically was struggling to sort of interpret the voltage level. It, I don't know, that even that doesn't really make much sense, so I'm not sure. So either sort of hot weather or something funny with this, I don't know really what it could have been, but this resistor does strangely seem to have sort of burnt out by itself. There's no obvious apparent cause as to why this is burnt. This is the scanned service manual that my uncle sent me about these igniter units, and I'm just having a look at the procedure they give to test it, which is a basic sort of procedure. Now they detail this as if you were using it on the bike, which is obviously what most people would be doing. They also say to use the Suzuki pocket tester, but elsewhere in the document they also say that you can use a standard analog voltmeter. They probably didn't mention digital multimeters because this is quite old and most people probably wouldn't have one, but yeah, it doesn't really matter. The point is, what you do is you normally would have it connected up to the bike. You pull the spark plugs out of the engine, you have them just on the frame there, and when you connect the probes of the meter, as they show here, to the input terminals in this particular manner, then it says here, the moment the test pins are connected, the spark plug sparks. So, basically, yeah, I should be able to and perform a test on this basically the same way, except I'll use a light bulb instead of the ignition coil because that's all I've got. So here's the basic test setup I've got, which is to basically mirror the basic test procedure they show in the service manual. I've got it hooked up to 12 volts for my power supply, and I've got a light bulb in place of the ignition coil on the one of the outputs, and I've got my voltmeter here set to diode mode, and if I connect that to the input pins, you'll see what happens. Well, first of all, I'll turn it on. So we turn it on and it does a brief flash. I don't know if that's normal, but that's what it does. And if I connect this negative to the this pin here, pretty much every time I touch this contact, you should see the light go, or at very least the current meter on the supply will go up. It all sort of depends, I think, on how well this connects when you touch it, but you see that way it went up. It almost lit the bulb, but it didn't light straight away. But you hit it a few times, and it's very repetitive every time you touch this. The light lights, and if I put the clip on the other one and do the other input, we get the same effect. I think it has a delay on the first few times because you are charging up those capacitors on the input sort of first, and this meter maybe puts out less current than the coils on the bike as opposed to, but I mean it does seem to be working, at least going by what the service manual says. It's a very basic test. Just every time you press these, the output should basically the transistors are sort of open collector and they will pull the output low to ground, and whatever's connected, this is connected directly to 12 volts, and then when it goes through here it's grounded through those and turns on, and that all seems to work. So I mean this one, as far as I can test, this method is seems to be working. If I connect the other one, I can see if that works as well. So I did try to test these with a better test procedure. I had an idea of sort of simulating. I kind of guessed that the signal core is maybe generating a sine wave, so I got my signal generator and fed a sine wave into these inputs, and nothing happened. I couldn't get anything to work. So the only thing that seems to work consistently is doing this test, as they say in the manual. So I don't know what signal level these expect. I don't know what the waveform is supposed to be like. I don't know, you know, what polarity is supposed to be, positive, negative, both. I don't know how does it relate to each one. Are they supposed to be complete opposites of each other, 180 degrees out of phase, or not? I don't know. I mean, I wanted to test the obviously the timing advance feature, which this would have. But anyway, we can test this one using the same procedure, and funnily enough, we get one flash when we turn it on. And if I connect these here, we get exactly the same behavior. A few brief things until I guess the capacitors charge up, and then after that it's pretty much fine. And if I connect the other output, do the same thing here, it's exactly the same behavior. So, I don't know, I mean, according to this, they seem to work, which is sort of surprising given how burnt this resistor was and all that. But yeah, I mean, if this test is what the manual says proves the thing is working, well, it seems to be working. They both seem to be fixed now, so I don't know. Like I said, without actually plugging them into the bike and doing a test that way, that would obviously be the ultimate test, but for a basic thing, they do seem to be doing what they're supposed to do, what the official service manual says they should do when you test them in this way. So yeah, maybe they're fixed. So there we go. Are these fixed? I don't know, to be honest. I'd love to say with certainty that they're working perfectly now, but I really can't say that. I know probably a lot of people with bikes like this and these modules or similar would love to hear that this has solved all the problem, but unfortunately I can't say that. I mean, I know these things are quite expensive to replace, whether they're second-hand or aftermarket version. My uncle said that these ones were quite expensive to get. Possibly they're fixable. Maybe it's just a burnt resistor or shorted zener diode like I had on these two. I'm very tempted to send these back to my uncle after replacing this resistor with a correct one, replacing the zeners with 1 watt, 2 watt zeners, possibly also replacing the capacitors in these because they are going to be about 30 years old, probably due for replacement. I wouldn't be surprised. Also, I'd replace the little input filtering capacitors here. I think these are designed to filter noise spikes in that, some sort of metallized film, probably. One of these was very close to the burnt resistor in this one, so possibly it's been damaged by the heat. I'd definitely replace that just as a precaution, maybe both of them anyway, just due to age. Everything else seems fine though. The resistors seem fine, the other diodes seem perfectly fine, the transistors are good, so I might do that, possibly re-glue the new capacitors and then maybe just send them back to him and see if he's willing to test them out on his bike and see if they'll see if they work, because I really would like to see if these have actually been fixed or not. And like I said, if I can come back and say, hey, you know, all that was wrong was one burnt resistor, one shorted zener, and everything else is perfectly fine, then yeah, that'd be great, because I'm sure there are lots of people that have these and would hopefully be able to fix them if they could, without having to spend large amounts of money to buy possibly second-hand ones that are also just as faulty, or aftermarket ones that are really expensive. So hopefully. Otherwise, though, I hope this video was interesting. I hope it was useful, and I hope that in the future I can possibly come back and give a definite answer as to whether or not these have been fixed. But for now, I guess that's all I can say. So, hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you next time.